Good morning. Today we are going to discuss viral encephalitis and meningitis. See, viral meningitis can exist as a separate entity, but all viral encephalitis has a component of meningitis included in it. So what you get is essentially a viral meningoencephalitis. So either it would be aseptic meningitis, as we call it, viral meningitis, or it could be viral meningoencephalitis. The importance of this, I'll take you back to my own medical undergrad days. I had a very close friend. While we were doing our internship, one weekend he went home, had some mild non-specific respiratory symptoms apparently, and didn't come back on Monday. We went and he was already hospitalized. He had had seizures, high grade fever, and unfortunately we lost him. He would have turned 60 this year, just a week back. A very, very close friend. We used to share our hostel room. So whenever I start this class, I just remember him once before I start. Viral encephalitis and meningitis, we will discuss under these headings. But first of all, the importance of this. It has a high risk of morbidity and mortality, and it can occur at any age, starting from neonates to any age at all, including young, healthy people. It's just a viral infection. Sometimes it just goes out of hand. And even after many of these people recover, even after they recover, they have to live through their life with some sort of deficit, many of them, neurological deficits, behavioral changes, a lot of things which persist beyond the acute infection, because viral infections are all acute, but some of the repercussions down the line are also important to understand. It's important in India, and the reason is that it is endemic in many parts of India, especially Japanese encephalitis is endemic in in some of the states of the south, like Karnataka. It was well documented in the east also, in Bengal. But now the current most important geographical area where it is endemic is eastern UP. So eastern Uttar Pradesh, it's very, very endemic. And then in, of course, Assam and many other states, Andhra. So you find cases almost across 15 states in India. And essentially because it's mosquito-borne, we are not going to get rid of it easily, except that there is a very good vaccine for it. So you know, some of these things, another importance of these infections is that at least Japanese encephalitis is preventable, provided you immunize people in the endemic area regularly. They just need to have a vaccine in childhood, early childhood, about 1 year age, 1 to 2 years, and then after that maybe a booster may be required later in adulthood. And you can protect the population. So we have good vaccines for it. We also have, for herpes virus encephalitis, we have good treatment, and therefore it is extremely important to diagnose it. Diagnosis is not that difficult for herpes simplex virus encephalitis. Clinically, also there are signs which you can look for, the area of the brain involved, etc. Those are indicators. But there are also very good tests. In fact, herpes encephalitis, herpes simplex encephalitis, was one of the first infections for which the PCR, the polymerase chain reaction, was used with great success, and it became a gold standard. So even when I was doing my MD, even at that time when PCR had just about come in, it was already being used for herpes simplex encephalitis and had already become the gold standard at that time. So because before that, people had to do a brain biopsy, which is an extremely invasive procedure for diagnosing or confirming the diagnosis of acute herpes encephalitis. So see where we are now with that. The other most important reason why you need to know about viral meningoencephalitis is that you keep seeing new viruses coming up. You know, if you look at all the etiology that we know of acute viral encephalitis and meningoencephalitis, we are still at the tip of the iceberg. At the very most, if you do all the possible tests that are available, all the possible diagnostic tests, you may land up with a diagnosis in about 20-30% of cases. And therefore, there's a large proportion we still don't know what causes it, or at least we don't reach a confirmed diagnosis. And so we keep finding out that there are other viruses in circulation. There are new ones. Nipah virus, for example, which started off in Southeast Asia, changed completely when another strain came up, and that was very different in behavior when it reached West Bengal. Before West Bengal, it became endemic in parts of Bangladesh. Every year they have Nipah outbreaks, and after that, in the surrounding districts of West Bengal also, it started showing repeated outbreaks. About, I think, five or six outbreaks, and then the one which happened in Kerala, which would be in your recent memory too. So there are these new viruses which keep coming up, which get associated with meningoencephalitis. You know now that they are a cause, and they become more and more important with different modes of transmission, etc. So these are the reasons why you must know about viral meningoencephalitis. I have already shown you the layout. We will first talk about the etiology of these two conditions, then a bit about the epidemiology, the clinical presentation, the laboratory diagnosis, the prevention, and the treatment. So what is acute viral meningitis? It's an acute inflammation of the meninges. And I've written infection here because we are talking of viral meningitis, but there can be other inflammatory causes. I'm not going into that right now of acute meningitis. You very well know that acute bacterial meningitis is a clear-cut entity, and you have studied it. You know the causes, the most common causes of acute pyogenic or acute bacterial meningitis are Neisseria meningitidis, Streptococcus pneumoniae, and Haemophilus influenzae. But the viruses that cause acute viral meningitis, there's a long list. This infection, as I mentioned, we call it aseptic meningitis. I'll tell you why. I'll just show you the reason why we call it aseptic. But this may be accompanied is of may be accompanied by encephalitis also, but it can occur alone. The etiology among the group of viruses or the family of viruses, the enteroviruses or the members of Picornaviridae, family Picornaviridae, picoRNA, Picornaviridae, are important as a whole group of viruses for the for as a cause of acute viral meningitis. And these enteroviruses include poliovirus, Coxsackie A and B viruses, some of the ecoviruses, the Enterovirus 71, etc. So there are a number of them. I've just listed some of the common ones here. So as a group, these enteroviruses are capable of causing acute viral meningitis. The next most common cause is mumps virus, which can also cause acute viral meningitis. Mumps virus is a paramyxovirus, and so are Nipah and measles, and both of them can cause some amount of acute viral meningitis or various forms of encephalitis. Measles, for example, I'm not going to the details today, but there is a condition called subacute sclerosing panencephalitis, which it can cause, SSPE. But that's not an acute condition, and we are not going into too much detail of that today. That's a long-term complication of measles happening in child. You get measles infection in childhood, and then maybe few years down the line, usually any time after the age of 8 to 10 years, or if the age is also shifting, the spectrum is shifting as measles is being seen in older children because of poor protection or incomplete protection by the vaccine in the early years if you don't take the whole course, etc. So now it is shifted to the 20s. So it's an infection which a disease which starts manifesting after about less than a decade of getting acute measles infection, and it's quite terrible, subacute sclerosing paraencephalitis by measles, because it manifests very simply with deterioration in learning abilities. So parents will come and say, this child used to perform very well in school and now is suddenly not doing as well. That is the commonest way, because that's the age at which they are learning, say 10 years, 12 years. And the course downhill is very steep. It's very quick. The deterioration is very rapid, and it ultimately leads to mortality. So that these are some of the conditions which these viruses can lead to in the long run. It's a long-term sequel of measles virus infection. So, but to come back to what we were discussing, acute viral meningitis, enteroviruses, then mumps virus, and then occasionally herpes simplex virus, though usually it causes meningoencephalitis, but once in a while it can cause some recurrent forms of acute meningitis. We call it Mollaret meningitis. You don't need to know that name, but is one of the rare types of meningitis. More importantly, in our country, Japanese encephalitis virus, dengue, West Nile, all these flaviviruses, which are mosquito-borne and can cause acute meningitis also. The Japanese encephalitis virus, of course, is spread by the Culex mosquito, but dengue and West Nile, as you know, are spread by the Aedes mosquito. Among the flaviviruses, there's the Zika virus also, which has shown occasionally some CNS manifestations, but it's not a very common cause, and we don't see that much in India. Just some outbreaks in Gujarat and Rajasthan. Zika, that's also a flavivirus mosquito spread by Aedes. Okay, and then some rare ones like lymphocytic chorioamnionitis virus, etc. So there are a number of viruses, but I would say if you want to name the commonest ones, it would be enterovirus and mumps. Enteroviruses and mumps virus. So, what are the clinical features of acute viral meningitis? The clinical features are pretty similar to acute bacterial meningitis. So, clinically, you may not be able to discriminate between the two. You'll see fever of sudden onset, headache, neck stiffness, photophobia, and you will be able to elicit the signs of meningeal irritation like neck rigidity, Brudzinski's sign, Koenig's sign, etc., which some illustrations are there on the right side, but the clinicians will teach you more about these. Essentially, these are all signs of meningeal irritation, and if the spine is kind of put under some stress by bending, in a particular way, or then you know, there is pain, a sudden onset of pain because of the inflammation inside the meninges. So essentially, you are kind of bending or stretching the spine to elicit these. I think I missed. Okay, it will be in lab diagnosis. So when we come to the lab diagnosis, I'll discuss a little bit more about. We'll come back to viral meningitis. But before that, let's move on to the acute viral encephalitis, which is as different from the meningitis, where only the meninges are involved. This is an acute infection of the brain parenchyma. So the brain itself gets involved, not just the coverings of the brain. And the etiology, the common etiology, some of these can occur as focal outbreaks, like Japanese encephalitis, sometimes dengue, West Nile, because these are mosquito-borne also, but they, and the mosquito-borne ones, you know, they can lead to small outbreaks. But many of these are also sporadic. You will just see some cases, and there won't be any common epidemiological link. So sporadic cases, of the commonest cause of sporadic viral encephalitis is herpes simplex virus. And HSV-1, as you know, affects the upper part of the body more. It remains latent in the trigeminal ganglia. And therefore, from there, it can get reactivated and travel up. So whenever reactivation occurs in the trigeminal ganglia, there can be retrograde axonal flow. It can move along the axons, and it can go up to the brain. And that is how it can cause encephalitis. So after, so sometimes you will see it after primary infection also, after primary herpes simplex virus infection, the first time one gets it. But that is rarer. you will probably get it. You can also get herpes simplex encephalitis by reactivation of latent herpes virus. And you know the herpes viridae have this tendency to be latent, whether it is herpes simplex virus, which remains latent in the sensory ganglia, in the trigeminal or the sacral ganglia, depending on whether it is usually the upper part of the body, it is one and lower is two, but it's not, there are exceptions. And now we've in fact, increasingly we are seeing that HSV2 is becoming an important cause of encephalitis because it may also be harbored in the trigeminal ganglia because this is a sexually transmitted infection in some cases. HSV2 is sexually transmitted more commonly because it was associated with the lower, with the genitals, etc. But now it is being seen in the increasingly, especially in Western populations, that it's not just HSV1 but also HSV2 which is causing either you know, various manifestations of herpes in the upper part of the body. And this is possibly indirectly related to changing sexual behavior, oral sex, etc. So all these things are happening. When you come to flaviviruses, Japanese encephalitis of course is important in our country, and I've given you the reasons why. That's endemic in certain parts, for those who missed the initial part. Dengue of course is there, and dengue is now, you know, every time there's a dengue outbreak or an epidemic in any area, and dengue is actually hyperendemic in many parts of India, meaning all the four serotypes continue in circulation in various parts of the country, with one of them spiking every few years. So we are seeing more cases of dengue encephalitis now, and it is being recognized as an entity much more than it was earlier, because we are seeing more cases of dengue, and therefore a small proportion of them which go on to encephalitis are also being seen. And West Nile, which is localized mostly to the western part of the of India, mostly Rajasthan, Gujarat, the Western Ghat area. Then you have the rhabdoviruses. Rabies virus, of course, you know, I'm not going to discuss it today because you have a separate class on rabies. And there's a virus which is indigenous to India called the Chandipura virus. This Chandipura virus also from time to time causes outbreaks in some parts of the country of acute viral encephalitis. And then we have, of course, the paramyxoviruses, the members of the family Paramyxoviridae, like Nipah and mumps. And I have not mentioned measles here because acute viral encephalitis is a little rare. Mostly it would be post measles complications, like, you know, demyelinating complications, SSP, which I mentioned, subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. Acute can happen just after, so it is just post-infectious encephalomyelitis kind of situation. It's not an acute viral encephalitis per se mostly. That can happen in measles virus infection, also rubella, post-rubella also it can. And then you have the enteroviruses, which are well-known causes of encephalitis. Coxsackie, ECO, enterovirus, various numbers, especially 71. There are many other causes of encephalitis which we don't see in India. La Crosse encephalitis, Californian encephalitis, St. Louis, Western, Eastern, Venezuelan encephalitis, which you see in various parts of the world, including North America and South American countries. Some of these are associated with rodents. But I'm not going into the details of these. They don't really concern us in India that much. What are the clinical features of acute viral encephalitis? Again, fever of sudden onset, headaches. But in addition to that, because now the brain parenchyma is involved, so you may have signs of meningitis. I have not repeated them here, but signs of meningitis can also accompany. And as I said, all viral encephalitis is actually a viral meningoencephalitis, but not the other way around. All viral meningitis may not show signs of parenchymal involvement, but mostly if you have viral encephalitis, you will also see signs of meningeal involvement. And so what are those signs, what are those symptoms and signs? You will see seizures, which will be new onset seizures, not I mean, you know, just to discriminate it from epilepsy, which may have been there from before. So somebody who's never had seizures can suddenly start showing seizures. Changes in behavior. This is interesting because this is something we don't normally think about, but when the brain parenchyma is involved, there could be changes in behavior, personality, cognition. And sometimes they may be the main manifestation. You have a couple of days of fever or just nothing, maybe something just like an influenza-like illness, and then your behavior changes and all kinds of things start manifesting, sometimes even psychotic. So keep in mind that these things can happen, though there are rarer ways of manifestation. Mostly it will be headache, seizures, altered sensorium, eventually going into coma in many people. And there may be focal neurological deficits, and you can possibly, you know, show that there's cranial nerve involvement or some disruption of motor function, etc. In herpes simplex encephalitis, which I mentioned is one of the most common causes of acute sporadic viral encephalitis, specifically in adults, temporal lobe involvement is seen. And temporal lobe involvement, so naturally, all the functions associated with the temporal nerve, temporal lobe may be affected. So you can actually clinically localize it, and in the CT, etc., you can see the involvement inflammation in the temporal lobe, and in the EEG you will see some slow wave patterns, etc., which will be very typical of acute adult herpes encephalitis, herpes simplex virus encephalitis. But in if the same thing, the same virus, if it gets transmitted from the mother to the baby, and you may have, I don't know whether you had classes of congenital infections, but herpes normally does not get transmitted while the baby is still, you know, it doesn't get transmitted transplacentally as such, but perinatally it can get transmitted. So when the baby, when the mother is delivering the baby during a normal vaginal delivery, if the mother has genital lesions, then as the baby is passing through the birth canal, and this you know, herpes virus is being shed from those genital lesions, and the baby can acquire the infection. And that is a generalized infection, but it also has a component of neonatal HSV encephalitis. So in these babies you may see the typical vesicular rash, which is caused by herpes in the areas which are the presenting areas, the, you know, while the baby is going down the birth canal. And you may also eventually, many of these may show septicemic kind of picture, refusal to feed, inability to thrive, etc. And they could have herpes encephalitis. But this encephalitis in neonates, neonatal herpetic encephalitis, is a generalized encephalitis, unlike the adult one where specifically the temporal lobe is more often involved. So these are some of the features of acute viral encephalitis, which are common. Many of them are common to all the viruses that cause it. Now let's talk a little bit about the life cycle of Japanese encephalitis. I'm just trying to, although the image there is a Western image because there's a horse there, in India there would probably be a buffalo there next to those two kids, or a, you know, a cow or a buffalo, so some other cattle. So this is obviously drawn from some Western location, most likely CDC, but it gives you the concept. I couldn't find a better picture. So for the Indian context, the vector in India is the female Culex tritinio rhynchus mosquito, and there's normally a regular life cycle of transmission going on between the mosquito and some of the water birds. If you have driven down or you've taken a train journey through some of the rural parts of India where there's paddy cultivation, you will often see a buffalo sitting in the middle of the paddy field while the paddy field has standing water in it. That's the typical scenario. Just picture it, that there's a paddy field, nice green, freshly planted paddy there, and they fill up the field with a lot of water at that time. And in that, you can often see a buffalo standing with these white birds on sitting on top of the buffalo. That's where this, the natural cycle of transmission of this virus happens. So these are water birds. They are called either pond herons or cattle egrets. And they basically sit there and, you know, feed off ticks, etc., which are sticking to that buffalo most of the time. And in the meantime, these mosquitoes are breeding in those paddy fields, and they go and bite the water birds, and that normal cycle goes on. But since these cattle, the water birds are associated with these cattle, and then these cattle at the end of the day will not keep standing in that paddy field all the time. They'll go back to their peri-domestic settings, wherever they live, where they're going to be fed there, and so on. And they'll carry the infection from there, and from there it goes to man. And that's how man and these cattle actually become incidental or accidental hosts. If there are pigs in this scenario, that's even more dangerous because the pigs actually don't suffer too much infection. They don't, but the virus really amplifies in pigs. Now, please understand that if there is an epidemic of Japanese encephalitis going on, and you decide, okay, the pigs are the amplifiers and let me finish them off, which some of the Southeast Asian countries in the early years tried to do, that only enhances the chances that those mosquitoes are going to start biting humans and actually increase the spread during an epidemic. So though the pigs are the amplifier hosts, the main thing is to keep them a little away so that from the domestic setting, so that they are not so closely in contact with human dwellings. And but then in rural settings, these things will happen. If the pigs don't bring it in, them amplification is not happening, then in the cattle they can bring it in anyway. So this is how the cycle works in the normal setting. And you know, rice is a good crop in terms of farming, and many you see now even in North India, many areas have switched from wheat to rice cultivation, and therefore the spread of this is increasing across India. So you find even cases coming up in Haryana. We don't see too much Japanese encephalitis in Delhi. We look very often because we get patients of encephalitis and they are tested. But if you go to the slightly rural settings around a little further away, you can find it. And of course, I've told you in eastern UP it is very, very endemic in many of those districts there. But in many other states like Karnataka, Andhra, West Bengal, Assam, they show high incidence. Let's go on to the life cycle of the other virus, which has become important in recent years, and it has an interesting life cycle. See, this virus initially started in Malaysia, the initial reports, and at that time, again, the amplifier was the pig, and they didn't know too much about the reservoir. It was only later on that the reservoir was worked out, a little time after the first outbreaks in Malaysia, and then later on in South, and they figured out that it is actually the natural host or reservoir is the fruit bat or the pteropus, which incidentally seems to have a role in a lot of viral infections, right from the original SARS, not SARS-2, not SARS-CoV-2, but the original SARS. There was an association, it was associated with MERS. Also to some extent, but and then again associated with Ebola even, and a lot of other infections. So this pteropus or fruit bat, sometimes you see it hanging upside down in trees, in gardens, etc. And it gets infected. It doesn't die due to this. There's probably been some coevolution over maybe centuries, if not more. And the virus is shed in the urine and saliva of these infected bats. And when it comes in contact, and how does it now? So this scenario of this the Nipah virus, what was seen in Malaysia was different. And the strain which is there in Bangladesh and West Bengal and also was seen in Kerala recently is a bit different. And the life cycle, you see these pictures on the right side. You see that flying fox or fruit bat hanging upside down there on the tree. And in Bangladesh as well as in Bengal, although this same link was not seen in Kerala, they were breeding inside a well these bats, infected bats. But here, you know, they have this nolen gur, they have this gur which is taken from palm tree sap, and during a particular season they tap the trunk of the palm tree and take out this sweet liquid which is there inside it, the sap, and then they make gur out of it. But they also ferment it, etc., and they sometimes drink it as a slightly fermented alcoholic beverage also. So during the collection, they hang these matkas there on the tree, and they leave it for the night because it keeps, you know, the sap keeps trickling into those matkas. And at night, you see this done with infrared photography, this bat coming down and licking that same sap from there or from the matka. And if it is infected, then from the saliva it goes into that, and then once the people start drinking it without heating it or without making gur, that liquid, slightly fermented liquid, or just a sweet syrupy liquid, it can have this virus, and that's how the transmission continues. So there's some aerosolization of that, and that aerosol by the respiratory route can enter human beings. And if you see the distribution of this Pteropus fruit bat, you'll see that upper part of Australia, or even the eastern coast of Australia, much of Southeast Asia, much of the many of the islands here, and Southeast Asia and South Asia, most of India and Bangladesh, Pakistan, and even some of the islands close to Africa. All these are the global distribution of this Pteropus fruit bat, and you keep seeing outbreaks in some parts of this because the flight range of this bat is quite long. It can fly 200, 300 kilometers, and so slowly it is spreading to different parts of the world. Let's go to the lab diagnosis. And the lab diagnosis, the most important sample is CSF, but you can also take blood samples. And if you're trying to demonstrate the virus, because many, as I mentioned, Nipah and some of the other paramyxoviruses, they actually spread by the respiratory route, mumps. So you can also find it in respiratory samples. But by and large, what you will get is a CSF sample. Because people may not be really interested in the etiology specifically, except for herpes simplex encephalitis, where there is a specific drug for it. And so, how do you discriminate the CSF of viral meningitis, acute viral meningitis, from the others? And this table shows you that. I'm going to focus only on the viral and bacterial for now. The main points of differentiation are, so whenever you collect a CSF and you know how it is collected, you should know how it is collected with a lumbar puncture needle, following all aseptic precautions, all sterile precautions, because you don't want to actually go and infect the CSF instead of just trying to diagnose an infection. And so you take three small penicillin vials or small screw cap containers, and in that you allow the CSF. Once you've tapped the CSF, you know what level, etc., you can read up. It's the lower lumbar spine, where you go into the between the in the interspinal area with that needle, after cleaning everything with spirit and iodine, etc., and then with the ethanol and iodine. So you then go in and you let it come out naturally, because sometimes the pressure is very high and you have to be very careful not to do lumbar punctures in people who have high intracranial pressure, because there's a risk of herniation of the brainstem, and that can be fatal because the respiratory center is there. So you have to be very careful that you must know that this person doesn't have high intracranial pressure. If they do, then you probably need to start some something to reduce that, and then think about the LP, the lumbar puncture. Anyway, so when you have these three containers, where all do they go? So every time you take a CSF, whether it is acute bacterial meningitis, pyogenic meningitis suspected, or viral, you're going to take three containers. One will go for cytology, one will go for biochemistry, and the third one will come for microbiology. The cytology one in normal CSF, you can only see less than 5 cells per microliter. But if you see any cells, they will only be lymphocytes. In viral meningitis, or what we call aseptic meningitis, because there aren't going to be any neutrophils, so there'll be an increase in these lymphocytes above 5. Normally they would not go into thousands, they would go up to maybe a few hundreds, but they will only be lymphocytes. They may even be much less than 100. So that is the only thing you'll find in the cellularity, unlike bacterial acute bacterial meningitis, where you find maybe hundreds to thousands of neutrophils, not lymphocytes. So this is one important differentiation on cytology. And what is the biochemistry going to tell you? Biochemistry, because there are bacteria in acute bacterial meningitis, they use up the glucose, and so the glucose is less than 40 milligram per cent. Whereas in viral, it's close to normal. The normal range is about 50 to 60 or 50 to 70 milligram per cent. So viral, you won't find that because there are no bacteria using up that glucose. So the glucose will be normal. So that is another way to differentiate. So that, and then of course the last one is that the proteins in bacterial are going to be much higher, because bacteria are also producing a lot of protein, plus the neutrophils are there and so on. They are getting degraded, so there's much more protein there. Whereas in viral, again, it is pretty close to normal, maybe slightly elevated. So this is how, and the others are of course the chronic meningitis. I'm not going into that. Is due to chronic meningitis is due to either Mycobacterium tuberculosis or due to Cryptococcus, which is a common fungal infection of the meninges. But these manifest, they don't manifest as acute meningitis. They usually manifest as chronic meningitis. So I'm not going into that. So just on the CSF picture, even before you are going to demonstrate bacteria or presence of viruses, you can actually get a fairly good idea of what you're dealing with, just by doing a basic CSF examination, cytological examination for the cells in it, and by doing the biochemistry of the CSF. But if you want a specific laboratory diagnosis, and that is extremely important, especially in herpes simplex virus infection, because you can actually treat it with a specific drug. Then for HSV, you can detect the HSV DNA in the CSF by PCR or real-time PCR, and this is considered the gold standard. Earlier, we used to do culture and all that. It used to take time. You would hardly pick up about less than 10% of cases. So here with this DNA PCR, you can pick up a very good proportion of the HSV encephalitis. Japanese encephalitis, normally it is tough to demonstrate the virus in the CSF. You can do it. You can try and grow the virus. You can do a PCR. But it is much more convenient just to look for IgM antibodies to the virus in the CSF. It's faster. And you do an ELISA to look for IgM antibodies, a mu capture or a IgM capture ELISA. And you can also look for it in the serum. So sometimes you may not be able to pick it up in the CSF because the amount of the antibody or the antibody response is not that good. But you would pick up in serum, and therefore that would also be supportive evidence. So if you find IgM in either the CSF or the serum of suspected Japanese encephalitis case, that is considered reasonable evidence, supportive evidence. Nipah, again, you can detect it in the Nipah virus RNA in CSF, nasopharyngeal swabs, urine or blood by real-time PCR. So this is how we diagnose. I'm just covering these three viruses today, as you can see. Enteroviruses, again, if you know, because we talked a little bit of meningitis also at the beginning, and it can cause meningitis as well as aseptic meningitis as well as acute viral encephalitis, you can again do a PCR on the CSF for enteroviruses. And there's a group common primer at the 5 prime end of this genome, where you can just do a PCR, a simple PCR on that, and say that okay, one of the enteroviruses is there in this sample. So it's a group-specific real-time or regular conventional PCR, which you can do. And basically, it amplifies a part of the 5 prime end of the genome of the enteroviruses and picks up all enteroviruses without actually identifying which one it is. So PCR can be used for that also. I'm sorry, I forgot to write it here. Then coming to prevention, Japanese encephalitis, Nipah, we've already talked. So Nipah, of course, it is more to do with, tracing the bats and finding out where the source of infection is, and then, trying to put up protective measures so that those bats are, you basically have to capture them and, destroy them using all biosafety precautions, etc. In that scenario. So the thing is, and mosquito control is important in Japanese encephalitis because it's due to Culex, spread by Culex. But for Japanese encephalitis, we have very good vaccine. And this vaccine is an inactivated or killed vaccine. This is what was used earlier. Inactivated and killed means the same thing. So this was either earlier it was grown in suckling mouse brain, but why suckling mouse? Because adult, so this suckling mice are a common model for arboviruses. You can grow arboviruses in the brain of suckling mice and newborn mice who are still feeding on milk from the mother. So these suckling mice, you inoculate 0.03 ml, just 30 microliters of the CSF into the brain very, very carefully without touching them too much, without using any disinfectants. Because if the mother senses that you've been handling that mouse, she will simply eat it up the next day from the litter, because these are all programmed into our genetically programmed into our behavior, because you want to protect the rest of the litter, the rest of the suckling mice who have been born along with that one. And if they find any trace of anything, that somebody's handled it or whatever, any evidence, then they destroy that mouse, they eat it up. There's cannibalism, and so that the others don't get infected. It's a natural response. So one has to very carefully, we used to do this here, but now because of animal ethics issues, etc., we don't do that anymore. There are more convenient methods and more humane methods of reaching the diagnosis. But it was used for making vaccine, and in India for many, many years, suckling mouse brain vaccine was used in the JE endemic areas. Even now, some of it is being produced and used in India. Why suckling? Because if you use adult animals, you use brain, and this has been seen in rabies also, for making, like sheep brain vaccine or all those kind of things, then there's a lot of myelin, and that myelin causes a lot of allergic reaction, neurological neurological demyelinating conditions due to the antibody to the myelin, there is less myelin in newborn CNS, and so we use suckling mouse brain. But now much of the virus is being grown in cell culture, and the cell line used is primary baby hamster cells. So in primary baby hamster cells, cell culture, you can grow this virus, the Japanese encephalitis virus, then inactivate it, kill it, and then use it as a vaccine. But in the last decades, it has been switched to live attenuated vaccine. There's a strain, a Chinese strain called the SA14142 strain, which China has used with great success against Japanese encephalitis, and this vaccine is being used by many countries now. And it's a safe vaccine, live attenuated, given normally at around 1 to 2 years of age in the endemic areas, and then if required, a booster in adulthood if there are outbreaks going on and you feel that these people have lost their protection. But the live attenuated one actually gives very good long-term protection. So these are the two vaccines, and therefore you can actually prevent Japanese encephalitis. HSV can also be prevented in neonates, not in adults, because in adults they are actually harboring the virus already much of the time, and it's just a reactivation. And almost 60-70% of us would be harboring one of the herpes viruses, and if at some point of time due to immunosuppression or something triggers it, and then it can get reactivated. Now every time it gets reactivated, it doesn't go to the brain, so it's not that. Mostly you'll see if it gets reactivated, HSV-1, then it will come down from that trigeminal ganglion, cause a few vesicles around your lips, and push off after a few days. It will be irritating, but nothing more than that. Very, very, very rarely. It may go up by retrograde axonal flow and reach the brain. So that we can't really stop. We can't do much about it because many of us are harboring the virus already. And it is not just spread by HSV-1 can be spread by just from saliva of infected people, just by close contact, etc. It's not spread by the sexual route. 2 is more likely because it's in the lower genital tract to be spread by the sexual route, but 1 can be spread by the sexual route through oral sex. Okay. So this HSV, basically you can prevent transmission of neonatal herpes, because then, you know, when you are going to deliver the baby, you normally inspect the genital tract of the mother, and at that time, if you find any suspicious looking lesions, you can take a call to do a cesarean, so that the baby is not exposed to the risk of herpes. It's tough to get a diagnosis on the spot at that point of time. It takes time and the delivery is not going to keep waiting for you. So mostly if you find lesions, suspicious lesions that look like herpetic lesions in the genital tract of a woman who's about to deliver, you can go for a cesarean section instead of a normal vaginal delivery and prevent the baby from getting neonatal herpes. Finally, coming to the treatment, most of the treatment of acute viral encephalitis or meningitis would be supportive management. I'm not going to the details. It is purely supportive, but there is a very good antiviral drug against herpes simplex encephalitis, and that drug is acyclovir. It has changed the whole scenario. Earlier, there were toxic drugs, and therefore, even to confirm the diagnosis, you had to go for a brain biopsy. Now, you can get a diagnosis of herpetic encephalitis just by doing a CSF and doing a PCR quickly, and you can treat it by this very safe drug. Even if you don't have a confirmed diagnosis, you can still go ahead with this drug if you are very sure of your clinical diagnosis. And parenteral acyclovir is highly effective. You give it in a dose of 60 milligram per kg body weight in 3 divided doses per day, and it works beautifully. How it acts is acyclovir, basically it has to be converted to acycloguanosine monophosphate, and this conversion happens only by the HSV infected cells by the HSV thymidine kinase. So that way it becomes a very specific drug. It's not going to target normal cells, only those that are infected with herpes simplex virus. It will target the thymidine kinase of the herpes simplex virus, is going to convert it into the first step, from acyclovir to acycloguanosine monophosphate. It's a nucleoside analog actually. And then at the next step, then the cellular kinases will convert it into the acycloguanosine triphosphate, which is the active form. And then this active form also acts only on HSV DNA polymerase. It acts on the cellular DNA polymerase also, but to a much lesser extent. So you have two checks at two points. One is at the thymidine kinase level. The other is at the point at which it acts on the DNA polymerase, more likely to act on the HSV DNA polymerase than on the cellular DNA polymerase. And that makes it a very safe drug. And what happens is it gets incorporated into the viral DNA, and because it is acyclovir triphosphate, it inhibits the further synthesis of viral DNA and viral replication. So this is a very important drug. It's also used for treating other forms of herpetic infection, also used for varicella zoster infection in a higher dose, etc. But here, this is where the most important and most useful action is seen. So with that, we come to the end of this lecture. So we have discussed about the 3 key viruses which have not been covered. One was herpes simplex virus, which causes sporadic encephalitis and is one of the commonest causes. We discussed briefly about enteroviruses and meningitis and encephalitis, and then we of course covered the ones which have epidemic potential, like Japanese encephalitis, which is endemic in parts of the country, and Nipah virus, which is a fast emerging virus. Thank you so much.
बाद में ले लेना, टाइम हो गया, देखो आपको भी लोगे ले लो फिर
समय
करो
ये कमेंट।
कोनो कुछ नहीं
यहां 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 लिखो ना ये लो
83603 क्या फोटो लोगे
मैं करूं एक मिनट दो
करो सर एक साइन
नहीं शीट
अगर
कोई ना ले तो रिकॉर्ड तो है ना आपके पास कौन कौन आया था
नहीं सर बस ठीक है हो गया मैं
ऊपर कर दूं यहाँ पे बॉक्स कर दूं
हाँ जी सर
ओके नीचे आप बच्चों का नाम लिख दीजिए हाँ
सर पोलियो
हाँ पोलियो
नमस्ते
सर
आपके लेक्चर की साथ में
रिलीज करते हैं हां सर क्या आपकी पढ़ाई है
ठीक है मुझे भी आपसे जेआर की साथ के साथ भी तो टाइम नहीं है इस वजह से थैंक यू सो मच सॉरी फॉर द कंफ्यूजन सर सॉरी मैं तो आगे जा रही हूं बिकॉज़ इस टाइम में तो ये जेआर फिर मैंने फिर आना
चाहता ठीक है अब रिकॉर्ड है
ठीक है
Good morning to all. I hope I'm audible and are the slides visible. You can reply on the WhatsApp to me so that I can proceed. Dr. Swati is here. You can even tell her. So once I get a yes from WhatsApp from Lohit, anyone on CR or the anyone can WhatsApp me now. If I'm audible and the slides are visible.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay. So should audible I start? And...
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So today I'll be discussing a very huge family of viruses, which is the picoRNA viridi family, which causes a myriad of syndromes in humans. So this lecture will encompass a lot of things, okay, actually. It'll cover meningitis to some extent, little bit, then we'll discuss skin manifestations, cardiac manifestations caused by viruses, etc. So with this, I begin with, this lecture actually is on picoRNA viruses, the members of the picoRNA viridi family. The most important member of that family was polio. But we, as we all know, that polio was is eradicated from India. For many years, we are not having wild circulation of polio viruses. So the other non-polio enteroviruses and the non-polio picoRNA viruses have become important clinically because they are the ones which are now what we see in causing clinical infections and disease. So I'll discuss the history of poliovirus, a bit about the picoRNA viruses, their taxonomy, their molecular virology, then the poliomyelitis disease, and how the disease has been eradicated from our country, although we still have three countries where from where wild polio is reported, but importation from these countries can be a problem. So we need to continue vaccination for polio till it's eradicated from the globe, which it hasn't yet, and hence the concern. We'll discuss the laboratory diagnosis of enteroviral infections, polioviral infections. I'll discuss clinically what is acute flaccid paralysis, the differential diagnosis, the surveillance, vaccines, then two important concepts associated with vaccines, VAPP and VDPV, which I'll discuss in a brief, and then other picoRNA viruses, which now are the future positive pathogens we need to worry about. Because polio is gone, but nevertheless, the other the other viruses are of importance now, because polio, with the reduction in the incidence and the with the eradication of polio, at least in many parts of the world, the other viruses have now taken their the place of polio virus. Am I audible? Yeah. So, the history of polio is very, very ancient. As you can see from this Egyptian tablet, which is at least 3,000 to 4,000 years old, it shows paralysis in which a peculiar position, polio, paralytic polio manifestations are seen clinically in the limb, and the person is using a stick to walk. But in modern history, the history of polio starts with 1909, where Landstein and Popper experimentally transmitted polio to primates and showed the transmission of the virus to primates, from humans to non-human primates. Then Ender, Weller, and Robbins isolated the virus in cell culture, and the Nobel Prize went to them for this in 1949. They did this, and 54 was the Nobel given to them, and the vaccines which came in 53 and 60. So let's see these in a bit detail. 1909, Carl Landstein and Erwin Popper, they reported the experimental transmission of polio to monkeys, and they inoculated the spinal cord from human cases, fatal cases of polio, and the fecal extracts from the human cases of polio, and filtered them and inoculated them into monkeys fecally, and showed the similar pathogenesis and changes in monkey primates. This was a big landmark animal experimentation, almost more than 100 years back. That's Landsteiner and Popper. Then came three scientists, Enders, Weller, and Robbins, that is John Franklin Enders, Thomas Huckel Weber, and Frederick Robbins, who in 1949 isolated in cell culture using non-neural cells polioviruses and demonstrated the cytopathic effect of this virus, and that's 70 years back, and they got the Nobel for this in 1954. Enders, Wellers, and Robbins. And then two discoveries of the regarding vaccination of polio. Jonas E. Salk developed the inactivated polio vaccine, that's IPV, inactivated polio vaccine, in 1953, and an institute was made on his name in the 60s. Of course, the most successful of the vaccines which came later was the oral polio vaccine by Albert B. Sabin. And this is both these vaccines by Salk and Sabin are still being used today. Now, the family picoRNA viridae has four genera of human importance: the enteroviruses, the paricoviruses, the hepatoviruses, and the coboviruses, of which the biggest group of viruses lie in the enteroviruses species, enterovirus ABCD, along with rhinovirus ABC. And these together constitute the genus enterovirus. So enterovirus species and rhinovirus species belong to enterovirus genus. And all these viruses include examples like polioviruses, Coxsackie A viruses, Coxsackie B viruses, ecoviruses, and numbered enteroviruses from 68 onwards till many, many more numbers now. And 68, 69, 70, these are clinically very important in various diseases. Human nanoviruses, we have had discussed in 2 minutes. We have discussed this in our respiratory virus class. Human nanoviruses cause rhinitis, or common cold, or coryza, and we have discussed this in our respiratory virus class earlier. Paricoviruses are very similar to ecoviruses, so they were they are morphologically similar to ecoviruses, biologically and morphologically, but genetically they are very different. So they were separated into a new species and genus, paricoviruses. There are 14 paricoviruses now, and they are important neurotropic viruses in humans. Hepatitis A virus, I have discussed hepatitis A, B, C, D, E a few months back, so we will not discuss that. IG virus, a small few case reports of gastroenteritis caused by IG virus, but again, their etiology is not confirmed yet. They were isolated from diarrhea stools, but still to be confirmed that they are two pathogens, so we will not discuss them any further. Other viruses from cattle and mice, which are similar in names, you just need to not remember them at all, actually. So what we focus today is enteroviruses, that is polio, coxsackie, A, B, eco, and other enteroviruses, paricoviruses, along with which are similar to ecoviruses biologically, but genetically dissimilar. So these are the few viruses which I'll discuss today. Rhino and hepatitis have been discussed in their respective clinical classes. In the clinical hepatitis class and the respiratory virus class with us earlier, which both I think I took with you guys. So, now the syndromes caused by enteroviruses are many, and there are many serotypes causing each. So this table from any book you open, whether it's Robbins, whether you open Harrison, or whether you open Javid's Microbiology, you'll find this table there. You don't have to mug this table now, but as you discuss these syndromes, automatically you will fit in the viruses which cause the important viruses. Are what you should remember. You don't need to remember each virus, but you should remember at least the one or two common ones in each group. So I'll discuss them one by one. Don't worry. This table will be very easy with you once we finish the class. So all enteroviruses, all picoRNA viridae family members have the same 30 nanometers virion. They are single-stranded RNA, which is linear, positive sense. The viruses are non-enveloped, and they are stable at acid pH. And they have you have the non-structured proteins inside, and then you have these structured proteins, VP viral protein 1, 2, 3, and 4. VP 1, 2, and 3 are on the surface, and VP 4 is a little in the inner side, and then you have the nucleocapsid associated with the RNA and many, many other non-structured proteins coded by the virus. The viruses are RNA viruses, so they all replicate in the cytoplasm, nothing to do with the nucleus, and they form these structural and non-structural proteins important for virion assembly and for replication. You don't need to know the detailed life cycle or replication of this virus at this level. Based on the neutralization, now polio. What is polio and what is poliovirus all about? Thankfully, we have eradicated the virus from our country by continuous efforts of vaccination by OPV, and of course now we have also added IPV. And based on neutralization using specific monoclonal antibodies, we have three polioviruses, poliovirus 1, 2, and 3. The each poliovirus has its own prototype strain. Like you can remember one of those strains, Brunhilde for 1, Lansing for 2, Lyon for 3. And of these three viruses, poliovirus 1 caused most epidemics globally throughout the globe. It was the most common cause of poliomyelitis. And poliovirus 2 usually caused endemic infection, not outbreaks. And PV3 had caused a few outbreaks and has the potential to cause bigger epidemics also. Luckily, poliovirus 1 is still existing in three countries of the world. Other than that, it's eradicated from the globe. Poliovirus 2 and 3 have been eradicated from the globe altogether. So there's no wide circulation of poliovirus 2 or 3 globally. Poliovirus 2 was eradicated almost 22 years back in 1999, and poliovirus 3, PV2 was eradicated from the globe in 2012. That's almost 9-10 years back. But poliovirus 1 is still a problem in some parts of in three countries, when we talk of wild circulation of these viruses. Now, how the viruses one? Now, all these viruses, the enteroviruses, paricoviruses, they enter the body and cause disease via the fecal-oral route. Once they enter the body, they use CD155. That is, which is a transmembrane glycoprotein of the immunoglobulin superfamily, which is found in the entire gut. It's on the surface of the epithelia, is the receptor used by the virus to enter into the body. And basically, the function of the CD155 molecule is intracellular adhesion junctions in the epithelial cells of the body. Once the viruses enter the gain entry through the fecal-oral route, they enter via using CD155 on the epithelium and become intracellular and replicate, and then from there they spread via the neurons, the nerve endings, to reach the central nervous system, and they can reach anywhere in the body. Now, once the virus enters the body and enters the gut epithelium, they replicate in the gut epithelium, and from there they also replicate in the local lymphatics, whether it's in the head and neck, the tonsils, or the Peyer's patches in the gut, and also the regional nodes everywhere elsewhere. And they replicate from the endothelium, they enter into the lymphatics and the lymph nodes, replicate there, and lead to a primary viremia. So once they enter the body, they replicate in the epithelium, the lymph nodes, and cause a viremia. After this viremia settles down, and then they are localized mainly in the monocyte macrophage system, which is throughout the body, and they replicate in the monocyte macrophages of the body, and attain high levels of viral titer in these cells, and ultimately they release out from these cells and lead to a secondary viremia. It's during the secondary viremic phase that they now enter through the nerve endings and reach the CNS by retrograde neuronal transport. Once they reach the CNS, they mainly damage the spinal cord, or to some extent the brainstem, and the main site of neurotropism is the anterior horn cell. So that's how the viruses which cause CNS disease, and this applies to all microRNA viruses which cause CNS damage, exemplified by polio, but the same applies to all how the virus reaches in the body and how the virus in a few cases causes CNS disease or damage. Poliomyelitis is a paralyzing disease of children. The most vulnerable age for polio is 6 months to 3 years, and these cases are usually seen wherever in the world you see them now, is from June to September in the rainy season. So if the rains happen in a different season in that country, it will be in that season where the rains happen. In India, the peak was June, July to September, when we had polio in our country. Incubation period is 1 to 2 weeks. It ranges from 3 days to a month or more. And most infections, the good point is the infections are subclinical. So 90 to 95% infections are subclinical. The virus enters the body, the immune system tackles the body. The virus replicates, as I discussed, the entire life cycle is same. But in them, the immune system tackles the virus and no clinical disease develops. In those few people who have clinical disease, the disease has three forms: mild disease called abortive poliomyelitis, non-paralytic poliomyelitis, and paralytic poliomyelitis. So let's discuss these three in brief. Only 4 to 8% of all those who are infected develop mild disease. This occurs during primary viremia. So minor illness or mild disease is during the primary viremia. Then the virus here is in the replicating in the monocyte macrophages, and then the secondary viremia, remember? So during the primary viremia phase, the patient may have, the child may manifest with fever, pharyngitis, and malaise. So these are not neurological features at all. So, and it's so mild and so transient in most cases that nobody even seeks medical attention during this phase. And most of these infections, almost all, recover within a few days. Now, in 1% of the patients, they develop a non-paralytic poliomyelitis, which is actually an aseptic meningitis. Now, just in the morning, Sir covered about the meningitis, encephalitis. Of all causes of meningitis, whether bacterial, viral, all put together, this group of viruses, enteroviruses, are the most common cause. And polio was an important cause earlier. Now it's, of course, eradicated from our country. So it manifests, non-paralytic polio manifests in only 1% individuals, and it is as an aseptic meningitis with neck rigidity and other features of meningitis. To be differentiated from pyogenic bacterial meningitis, which is septic meningitis, viral meningitis is aseptic meningitis. Of course, other organisms also, bacteria can also cause aseptic meningitis, but viral meningitis almost always is aseptic meningitis. It manifests with neck rigidity and Brudzinski's sign and all those which you will be taught in the clinical classes. And this also lasts in 2 days, and recovery is rapid and complete in most cases. So most children with non-paralytic polio also recover from the aseptic meningitis within a few days, or a little more than that. But the worrisome part is stage 3, is but it's stage 3 of the disease, that is paralytic polio. As I discussed, the tropism of this virus, or the of this polio virus, is the anterior horn cell. So it leads to lower motor neuron damage and causes an acute flaccid paralysis. Less than 1% of the patients will develop paralytic disease. Brainstem may be involved in some cases, which may lead to more pathogenicity and more clinical features, but almost all patients, most patients have acute flaccid paralysis due to lower motor neuron damage of the anterior horn cells. The paralysis is focal initially and spreads a little to more areas. And the good point is maximum children recover from this paralysis within 6 months. Okay, few muscle groups show residual paralysis. Now, look at this diagram. This diagram shows which group of muscles show more paralysis. The shoulder muscles, the muscles behind the arm, which make so there's weakness in straightening the arm. The back muscles, then you have the thumb muscle. Then you have muscles which straighten or bend or those which spread or close the legs. Those muscles are the ones which are more prone to residual paralysis, and those which strengthen the knee, and muscles which lift the foot. So there's foot drop. So many of these areas where residual paralysis remains, contractures also develop, with muscles becoming tight cords. So it's a very debilitating neurological disease. That is paralytic polio, which is an acute flaccid paralysis with residual paralysis and contractures which ensue in the few weeks, months, or years down the line. Let me tell you one, share something very, very sad. When I was a child, when I used to go to my native town, from Delhi to my native village, I'm talking about 1970s, when I was a very, very small child, it was very common for me to see in my village children with walking like this. It was every 1 in 20th child used to walk like this and had paralytic polio. That time there was vaccination was still not developed or not available, and it was sad to see many individuals, healthy, young, brainy children developing polio and becoming vestiges in the society. The good thing is, with widespread vaccine coverage, polio is now no longer a problem in our country. But I remember my childhood. I have seen innocent children walking like this in villages, and this was a very common sight in the 70s, 60s, 50s. Ask your parents and they'll tell you, especially in small towns where it was much more seen. Of course, it was seen everywhere in our country. Now, that's the story about polio and its clinical spectrum. But one more thing which troubles polio patients is progressive poliomyelitis muscle atrophy, or post-polio syndrome. Now, many years or decades after having paralytic polio and the disease has settled, it has not increased any further and has reached its maximum, there is recrudescence of polio or paralysis, and muscle wasting. And this is not due to persistence of virus or reactivation of virus. It is a physiological aging phenomena in these patients, which are already burdened by loss of neuromuscular function. So post-polio syndrome is another issue which polio patients have to tackle many years down the line, which is physiological or changes or aging changes in these group of muscles, where the neuromuscular function is burdened by the loss of musculature and function. So this diagram shows the same thing. When you talk of fever, it is a biphasic fever which coincides with primary viremia and secondary viremia. Here, once a virus is, now in this second panel, once the virus enters the body through the picoral route, via the nerves it reaches, it replicates in local nodes, causes a primary viremia. From there, it replicates in the local monocyte macrophage system and causes secondary viremia. During secondary viremia, via the nerves, it retrograde transports to the CNS, and then serum antibody appears after secondary viremia phase and persists for many months to years. Antibody in the throat secretion also is appeared, but at a low level much later. When you talk of kinetics of the virus, replication of the virus in the tonsil, as shown in this yellow bar, can be seen throughout primary and secondary viremia. In a few, up to 3 weeks, the virus can be recovered from the throat. So a throat swab collected in BTM can be used for PCR or for virus culture. Okay, the red line here is in throat secretions. In the Peyer's patches, it is seen throughout for 3 weeks, but in the throat, it is in the first 10-11 days or up to maximum higher levels up to 10 days, and the virus comes down by the second by the end of second week in the throat. Okay, shedding of the virus in throat secretions. Virus in the feces is also seen a little later, more in the end of first week or second week, and it also comes down by day 10. Virus in the blood persists for a short time again, and is not of clinical significance as far as diagnosis is concerned. Virus in tissues of CNS is seen best at the peak of secondary viremia and then comes down the line. I'll share these slides with you, and you can have a look at them at in your on your computers. Now, what is the now that polio is an important cause of acute facet paralysis, and now that polio has gone from most parts of the world, this is the list you as clinical budding doctors should know. Other enteroviruses have now become the important cause of acute facet paralysis. Other viruses rarely, like West Nile virus, rabies. Now, rabies has two forms, remember? Dr. Megha must have taken the class. Furious or encephalitic rabies in 80%, 20% present with AFP. So, when a patient presents with not with encephalitis and hydrophobia and has acute facet paralysis and history of dog bite may be available or may not be available, rabies, paralytic rabies should be in your mind also, because 20% of rabies is presenting as acute facet paralysis, also called paralytic rabies. Some adenoviruses have caused AFP. Clostridium botulism causes acute facet paralysis. Non-infectious diseases like acute transverse myelitis, Guillain-Barre syndrome, which is triggered by as an immunological phenomenon to many infections, traumatic neuritis, Ray syndrome. I have discussed Ray syndrome in the hepatitis class. Snake bites like crate, mamba, and cobra bites can lead to acute placid paralysis. Curare, a chemical, can also lead to acute placid paralysis. How do we diagnose enteroviruses, polio, and other syndromes caused by these group of viruses? The samples usually, because it's a fecal transmission, the virus is shed in the throat. So feces is an important sample. Throat swab is an important sample. Blood, CSF. Blood, CSF in neurological disease may be helpful. Viral isolation and cell culture for these viruses can be done in a variety of lines. Primary monkey kidney cells, human rhabdomyoma RD cells, L20B mouse murine cells, and human epidermoid 2, that is carcinoma cervix cells. Now, what is important is, now what is the receptor for polio? CD155, I told you. Now, we have murine, this L20B murine cells have been genetically modified to express CD155. And this CD155 expressing murine's L20B cells are now the preferred cells to isolate polioviruses if required. Identification in cell culture is based on their cytopathic effect, and microneutralization tests using anti-serum pools. Anti-sera pools are available for the entire spectrum of polio enteroviruses and other picoRNA-viridae family members. And this antivirus, anti-serum pools are known as Lim, Benyesh, Melnick, LBM pools of anti-sera for enteroviruses. Molecular assays now are preferred. It's a RNA virus, so reverse transcription PCR and sequencing of the BP1 gene is important for typing of these viruses. Serology is of not of clinical significance, but it's important for in research labs for other users. Neutralization, complement fixation have been used for this. Okay. Now, this is the clinical case one. Now, this case, there were three phases of polio, remember? So you had mild disease, which was presenting with primary viremia phase, with fever, pharyngitis, malaise, inconsequential. Most people don't seek attention. You have non-paralytic polio, which is in 1% patients, with presenting with aseptic meningitis. And then you have paralytic polio with acute facet paralysis. We discussed that a few minutes back. Now, let's see the two important manifestations of polio. How will a patient present with, in different phases of polio? Phase one, abortive polio, hardly anyone presents like that because it's an inconsequential mild pharyngitis. Now look at this case. A three-month-old girl from a remote village in UP develops fever, restlessness, and unusual cry. These are followed by lethargy. On examination, she appears normal, who is minimally responsive to stimuli. Neck rigidity is positive. CSF shows predominantly lymphocytes, 200 WBCs per microliter. And there is history of incomplete, the vaccination history is not complete. This is a typical manifestation of aseptic meningitis caused possibly by polio. Of course, other viruses which cause aseptic meningitis also need to be ruled out. But This is how children with aseptic meningitis and polio presented when these were seen clinically in the 70s and 80s and early 90s. This is how a child with paralytic polio presents. A 10-year-old boy, a slum dweller, is brought to the emergency with weakness of the right lower limb. There is mild fever, sore throat history since 8 days, neck rigidity and vomiting since 2 days, and there is pain in the right lower limb since 1 day, and of course, history of incomplete vaccination. This is how a child with acute facet paralysis in the early phase will present, will be brought to in the emergency by the parents. So this case was aseptic meningitis, and this is acute facet paralysis, both as seen in polio. Of course, clinically it can be caused very similar by other viruses which cause these syndromes. Now, what is important is surveillance for polio. How was the surveillance done? The surveillance was aimed to identify all remaining infected areas where polio was circulating in those communities, to monitor progress in eradication, and target supplementary immunization in areas where immunization was lacking or was suboptimal. All children who have present with acute, now still the surveillance is going on. Although polio is no longer a problem for a few years in our country, but it's important to remember that three countries, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Nigeria, are still having wide circulation of polio. And because of international travel now, anybody can frequently be coming with carrying the virus in their GIT, and it may be shed in the community and may be spread via the frequent route. So all children who present with acute facet paralysis, and they are less than 15, especially if they are less than 15, have to be taken under surveillance for polio, and two stool samples have to be collected from such a child at least 24 hours apart and within 14 days of onset of paralysis. So important thing, any child presenting with AFP, acute facet paralysis, who is below 15 years of age, two stool samples, at least 24 hours apart, the samples should be collected, and they should be within 14 days of the onset of paralysis. They have to be sent to the WHO accredited labs in the polio network of the country, and they should be transported within 3 days of collection from the patient to these accredited polio labs, where the virus is isolated and detected by now by molecular techniques, that is reverse transcription PCR. Luckily, we have the vaccines for polio. Immunoglobulins were used in the acute phase, but they are not commonly available, and usually patients present late, so they are of dubious value if they are given late. The main thing is to give active immunity by vaccination to all individuals, which we still do now, so that we don't have resurgence of polio, because still actively some countries are having reporting wild polio viruses. So 48, 8, and 32 D antigen, the antigen of polio is measured in a unit called D antigen unit, and these three are incorporated in the killed injectable Salk vaccine. You remember the two people who made the vaccine, Salk and Sabin? So Salk vaccine is a killed IV injectable vaccine. The viruses which are grown in monkey kidney cells or diploid cells are inactivated by formalin, and then they are given in the form of an IPV, inactivated polio vaccine. IPV is given in 3 doses, 4 to 6 weeks apart, with booster 6 months later, every 3 to 5 years, till the child is above 15 to 18. Live oral vaccines are made by passaging the polio viruses in monkey and chimpanzee tissues in the kidney, testes, are also given orally, with plaque purification steps of the viruses. And depending on the which virus is circulating in the community, monovalent, bivalent, or trivalent vaccines are prepared for of this live oral Sabin vaccine, but have to be transported in cold chain. Otherwise, the vaccine gets inactivated, is ineffective. And the TCRE 50 doses of each are given here, and they are used in the vaccines depending on the area where wherever we require the vaccine and whichever circulating polioviruses are there. So 3 doses have to be again given for OPV, 4 to 8 weeks apart. So this is the standard. Most in India, the thrust was an oral polio vaccine. Now, what is the disadvantage and advantage of each of these two vaccines? That's very important. You definitely get short note on polio vaccines, a short note on IPV, a short note on OPV. Up till now, what we have discussed, let me discuss what are the short notes which come in the exam till now. First of all, classification of IQRNA validity, short note. You would need not mention the animal viruses, just the human viruses should do. The second short note The second short note which you get in polio is the pathogenesis of poliomyelitis and enteroviruses. The third short note is clinical spectrum of poliomyelitis, where you discuss mild disease, abortive, non-paralytic, that is aseptic meningitis, and paralytic polio, that is an AFP, acute flaccid paralysis. DD of AFP is an important short note in medicine and pediatrics. Live diagnosis of polio, short note, 3 marks, all of these. Then vaccines, polio vaccines, very important short note. Now, before we go on to the details of the vaccines and their pros and cons, let me remind you that even in US, there were issues with quality of vaccine. The important incidents I'll take you back to 1955, and that's 65 years back when the Qatar incident happened. Now, what is this Qatar incident? In April 1955, more than 200,000, that's 2 lakh children in some of the states of in the US received the polio vaccine, which was not properly inactivated. It was the vaccine, the IPV, which was not completely inactivated by formalin, and some of the viruses were still not dead. So the viruses which were not killed, which were alive, led to there were reports of paralysis within a few within a month of the mass vaccination program, which was started in these states and had to be immediately abandoned. Further investigations revealed that the Qatar laboratory, which is a California-based company, this incident had caused 40,000 cases of polio, 200 children with paralysis, and 10 children dead due to this inactivated vaccine. This is one of the worst worst medical disasters as far as immunology and vaccination is concerned, the Qatar incident of the US. Now, what is the advantage and disadvantage of, and the what are the attributes of these two vaccines? The IPV, Salk vaccine, is a formalin inactivated vaccine, has to be given as an injectable intramuscularly. Oral OPV is a live vaccine. Of course, it has to be given maintained by cold chain and at 4 degrees, and then it has to be given orally. Cystic immunity is best with both. Both give high systemic immunity. But in test, because OPV is given orally, orofecally, in the same route the way the virus enters the body, so intestinal immunity is very high, which is not bad, but it is low with IPV. Herd immunity is nothing with IPV. What is herd immunity? Herd immunity is vaccination of the entire community because of shedding of the vaccine strain frequently in the vaccinees. So once a vaccinee sheds the vaccine strain in him, he's not only protecting himself or herself, the shed virus in the community by frequent transmission also indirectly protects other people who were not immunized. And this the original concept of herd immunity is by OPV, and this vaccine also gave herd immunity. Hence, in our community, where fecal-oral hygiene is not the best even now, it is much improved, of course, this vaccine was preferred over IPV for polio vaccination. And the success of our vaccination program was a big victory came because of OPV. Of course, this is an oral vaccine, so it's a live vaccine. The vaccine is live. So there's a small chance of mutation in the virus to revert back to and cause vaccine-associated paralytic polio. This is called VAPP. VAP is ventilator-associated pneumonia, and VAPP is VAPP. VAP is a vaccine-associated paralytic poliomyelitis, and it can be seen with oral vaccines, or the risk is very low. Okay, and it is not due to improper inactivation of the vaccine. It is due to it's not because of the attenuation is not good. It's that the nature of the virus to mutate, and it may revert back to its wild type and cause some paralysis. So even if you make a proper good vaccine, there's a very rare chance of risk of reverting back to pathogenicity. Okay, of course, if the patient is immunodeficient, you can give IPV, but because OPV is a live vaccine, it's contraindicated for immunodeficient people. Of course, OPV oral vaccine is less expensive compared to IPV. Now, let's look at these two charts. Both these vaccines, this is for IPV, this is for OPV, both induce good serum IgM, the red one, and a good serum IgG. Both induce good serum IgA also. okay, in the serum. But OPV advantage, it induces a good nasal IgA, local secretory IgA in the nose and throat, duodenum, look at this. In the gut, duodenal IgA and nasal IgA is two things which are not seen with IPV. Okay, they are very minimal there, so it's almost negligible. But with oral, when you give it orally through the gut, the replication in the local oropharynx and the tonsils leads to a good IgA response in not only the nose and the throat, also in the duodenum, which is the major advantage. That there is local secretory immunity in the gut, which protects the individual from further attacks by polioviruses, and it's the virus is shed in the community and contributes to herd immunity. That's the most important part and the cause of success of the OPV vaccine. Now, initially, when these both whether you use IP or OPV, you can see whether these strains are well attenuated. Okay, how? By certain phenotypic tests and of course now by sequencing of the VP1 gene. So initially, this is mainly for this is not asked in your UG exams at all, but you should know that growth in bicarbonate, growth at a particular temperature, growth stability in a cell line, or inactivation by anti-serum and neurovirulence in transgenic mice are the five criteria. D marker is for bicarbonate, RCT40 is for replicative capacity at temperature of 40, MS is stability in cell lines, Pegbrides, antigenic marker is using specific anti-sera inactivation, and neurovirulence in mice by animal experiments. These five criteria were used for knowing whether the strain is still wild or it has been attenuated for vaccine use. So the wild strain will grow well at bicarbonate high in this pH of bicarbonate at this temperature in this cell line will be by the anti-sera and will be virulent in mice. Whereas attenuated strain will not have these features, and this is how it was checked earlier. Now we have molecular markers in the genome of the virus by sequencing to know, because once you attenuate a strain for vaccine production, there are certain mutations which develop in the vaccine which are unique to attenuation. So nowadays these assays are preferred, but you should know this is a very important aspect, especially our PG should know this. Okay, so India started the Pulse Polio program in December 1995, and it was done that in such a way that after a few weeks in January they did the second phase of the program. So December 95, the initial dose of OPV was given to all children below the age of 5, and after 6 weeks in January in 96, few weeks later in January 1996, the second dose of OPV was given to all children, and this was on a single day throughout the country. So from Jammu Kashmir to Kanyakumari, everybody was given this, every child up to the age of 5, whether they have received earlier vaccination or they have not received vaccination, they were given this vaccine. Okay. And this did not replace routine immunization. And this was done and it is still being done. Now it is done in the months of November and February, between these months. And now OPV is besides this. So as you can see, in 1988, these were the countries where polio was reported. Then in 2002, only a few countries. Then with polio vaccination. Then we had only a few countries in 2006, even lesser countries. And now in 2018, 3 years back, only three countries, Pakistan, Afghanistan and Nigeria. Here, of course, the particular community was refusing to take the vaccination, because of which the program suffered. But here, in all these countries, let me assure you, the situation is improving, and the number of wild polioviruses reporting is much, much less. And we are hopeful that soon the whole world will be polio-free. That's a good part. The last confirmed case of polio was in October 2010 by poliovirus 3 in Pakur in Jharkhand. And the last actual case, this was the second last case. This last case came from Shahpara village in Howrah in West Bengal, and that was by poliovirus 1. And the last case of polio, this one from Shahpara, was Ruksar Khatun. After that, we have had no reporting of AFP or polio from our country by any in the wild. Then from 2011 and 2012, there was total interruption of circulation of endemic thanks to the vaccination, thanks to the people who took the vaccine, let me assure you that. And then, since then, in 2025, February 2012, India was removed from the list of polio endemic countries, and in March 2014, it achieved global eradication and certified polio free. But now, the WHO made the polio eradication an end-game strategic plan, which was implemented from 2013 to 18, which was basically stopping using OPV and shifting to IPV now. I'll tell you why in a minute. And with the objective of this end-game strategic plan was by the Global Polio Eradication Initiative, GPEI. And this end-game strategic plan was to interrupt basic points for these four. Detect the virus through active surveillance, interrupt the transmission of the virus, strengthen vaccination, strengthen now IPV, and gradually stop giving OPV, switching to OPV, certify the regions and countries of that they are having no wild transmission of polio, and planning and consultation with experts further and to build infrastructure so that nothing further happens and no resurgence of this virus happens. Now, the issues with OPV were the following. This is very important. What is two phenomena are known. Because we are giving OPV, which is a live vaccination, there could be reemergence of polio by mutation of the vaccine strain, and this could be transmissible and lead to neurovirulence and AFP. So two phenomena are associated with this, VAPP and VDPP. I've discussed VAPP. Vaccine-associated paralytic polio is the occurrence of paralytic poliomyelitis cases among the OPV recipients or their close contacts. Okay. During initial replication, the Sabin strains can revert back to neurovirulent variants to cause AFP. So VAPP, vaccine-associated paralytic poliomyelitis, is a rare adverse event following OPV, and it's a sporadic event. Okay, it could happen in the recipient or in the close contact of the recipient. So it's recipient VAP or contact VAP. On the other hand, vaccine-derived polioviruses, VDPVs, are emergence. Now, once you have given the OPV in the community to many, many people, now the virus sheds in the people. It's an OPV, it's an oral vaccine, fecally sheds. And now, as being an RNA virus where the mutations can happen, the same phenomena can happen. This phenomena which leads to, now one more important thing in VAP is that this paralytic polio occurs within a few days of giving the vaccine in the individual or the contact. Okay. So it's very fast change reverting back to the of the vaccine OPV strain to cause paralytic polio. Whereas VDPV is a phenomena wherein shedding of the viruses over weeks, the viruses acquire slow mutations and all become altered genetically and are able to shed in the community and replicate in the community and spread from one person to the other. Such virus which is more than 1% different from the wild virus in the VP1 sequencing or the VP1 gene. Okay, so remember I told you there are four structural proteins, VP1, 2, 3, 4 in the inhibition in the beginning. So the VP1 sequences are of very of prime importance in this deciphering whether you have VDPV or not. So if such a virus over the weeks of giving OPV gradually changes into mutates, and the VP1 shares genome sequence shows more than 1% divergence from the wild polio virus, and this strain is able to mutate, is circulating in the community. This is called as circulating vaccine-derived polio virus. Now, besides, this is in healthy people. The virus can change over time. It's an RNA virus, can mutate. If a person is immunodeficient, for example, a cancer patient, in such a patient, the virus will be shed for prolonged periods, okay, much more than healthy people. Or viruses which are found in a person in whom we don't know the history of vaccination, or sewage isolates from samples collected from sewage for surveillance, which show such mutations with more than 1% divergence from the wild virus. All these together are called vaccine-derived polioviruses, and these are of three types: circulating, immunodeficient, and ambiguous. And this table is there. I'll share with you. Read it up, and then you can discuss with me if you have any doubts. So because of this, the end game of India was started in 2015, and gradually now we have replaced all children. OPV is continuing, but IPV is now being given. And soon we'll have a polio-free world because of the end game strategic planning of polio. Now let's, in next 5-10 minutes, cover the non-polio enteroviruses. polio is going from the world, it's gone from India. But now, non-polio enteroviruses and other pico-RNA viruses are of importance. They cause neurological disease, acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis, some skin diseases, cardiac disease, and some respiratory disease, and some neonatal infections. So these are the six slides which I'll cover in the next 5 to 6 minutes. We have had a class just now on meningitis and encephalitis. So these are the important pico-RNA variety members. Poliovirus we have discussed. ECO, Coxsackie A, Enterovirus 71, which cause meningitis. In fact, we have just finished the meningitis class, so I'll not spend time here. The most common cause of viral meningitis, the most common cause of aseptic meningitis in children or adults are enteroviruses and paricoviruses, this group of viruses, these ones. This alone is the most common cause of meningitis, viral meningitis, in any part of the world at any age. The viruses which cause acute classic paralysis, we have discussed polio, Coxsackie A7, Enterovirus 70 and 71, all four are notorious to cause acute flaccid paralysis, amongst other viruses which I've discussed in the DD table with you. Encephalitis can, now some of these viruses, once they reach the CNS and cause aseptic meningitis, they can cross the blood-brain barrier and reach the brain and cause encephalitis. Enterovirus 71, Enterovirus 76, 81, Coxsackie A9, B5, ECO 1130, and some paricoviruses can cause encephalitis or sometimes meningoencephalitis. Mm-hmm. Then there are other rare syndromes caused by the virus. One is chronic meningoencephalitis with juvenile dermatomyositis, which will be taught in pediatrics. Okay. Acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis. Two pico-RNA viruses, Enterovirus 70 and Coxsackie A24, a variant of A24 actually, have led to outbreaks of acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis. Acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis is an acute viral conjunctivitis in which subconjunctival hemorrhages are also seen, which can lead to huge collection of blood in the eye. This is an extremely contagious disease and it has a very short incubation period of 1 to 2 days. Three major outbreaks, most of them caused by Enterovirus 70, have been reported in the globe. This 1969 and the 1981 outbreaks were by Enterovirus 70, whereas the 2002 outbreak was by Coxsackie A24. It is an acute conjunctivitis with subconjunctival hemorrhage. Some patients have also corneal involvement in the form of keratitis. Okay. The 1969 outbreak was a huge outbreak, started in Africa. From Africa, it went all the way to Asia, to Japan, and more than 50 million adults were affected mainly in 2 years throughout the globe. India, the peculiarity of this outbreak was that in India, this virus, the Enterovirus 70, which caused this outbreak in the globe, also led to CNS disease, radiculomyelitis in some patients. The Brazil outbreaks swept across America and US and Pacific Islands. The Korea 2002 outbreaks spread from Korea and spread in the neighboring countries with more than 1 million people. So the previous outbreaks were by Enterovirus 70 of AHC, acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis, but the recent outbreaks now are increasingly being reported by a variant of Coxsackie A24. Skin rash is a common manifestation of enteroviral and pico-RNA variety family members. It's usually a rubella-like macropapular rash by ECO 9 in nurseries and schools. The Boston exanthem, where it was first reported, was a roseola infantum-like rash. I'll be discussing roseola in my next class with you, and this is caused by ECO 16. Hand-foot-mouth disease is also an important vesicular rash, not maculopapular rash. The other two are maculopapular rash, one these two. This one is vesicles. I have a separate class with you on skin rashes, viral skin rashes and exanthems. So I'll cover hand-foot-mouth disease there also. Coxsackie A16, also 5 and 10, and Coxsackie B1, and Enterovirus 71, cause fever with rash and headache as the initial manifestation. The rash is vesicles on the palms and soles and in the oral cavity. In case of, if it is caused by enterovirus, these are six viruses causing hand-foot-mouth disease, in which Enterovirus 71 also sometimes can lead to neurological manifestations in these, neurological and cardiac manifestations in some of the children with hand-foot-mouth disease. Cardiac disease presenting as myocarditis and pericarditis and dilated cardiomyopathy are known, are established causes diseases by picoRNA viruses. Coxsackie B are mainly the cause. Coxsackie A and ECO viruses have also been implicated. And the most important cause of viral myocarditis and related complications are these picoRNA variety members. CSF is not the best sample. Myocardial tissue is the best sample. Pericardial fluid can also be used, although myocardial tissue is the most has the best diagnostic utility. Bornholm disease is a myositis. It's a disease of skeletal muscle. This is Denmark, just above Germany in Europe, and this is the island of Bornholm where this was first described as an outbreak. It is caused by Coxsackie B viruses, where paroxysms of stabbing pain of the chest, abdomen, and is observed. It is a disease which recovers gradually. It's not seen in children, but in older children and adults. It can happen in sporadic cases, one or two cases coming now and then, or epidemics where it's called epidemic pleurodynia. This is pleurodynia or Bornholm disease. Respiratory disease starting from rhinitis or respiratory failure can happen with picoRNA viruses. The most common is febrile cold, that is common cold, coryza, or sore throat, which comes under the term summer grip. Summer grip is a term used in temperate countries like US and Europe for in their summer months, they have these sore throats and colds. Etiology is Coxsackie A21, A24, ECO 11, 20, some Coxsackie viruses. These viruses have also caused summer grip or outbreaks of URI in military recruits camps, in camps of military recruits. Typically, A21, Coxsackie A21 is the most common agent in such outbreaks. Herpangina and enterovirus D68 is what I'm discussing in the next last two slides. Herpangina is a pharyngitis. It's a specific pharyngitis with fever. The important thing is that the pharyngitis leads to painful lesions in the soft palate. These lesions are either vesicles or nodules, lymphonodular, it's called pharyngitis, it's called in that case, otherwise vesicular pharyngitis. Etiology is Coxsackie A virus. The differential diagnosis is hand-foot-mouth disease, because in hand-foot-mouth disease, you have vesicles in the mouth. But here, the vesicles are in the tongue and the buccal cavity more, at least in the anterior part of the mouth, whereas in here, they are typically more in the soft palate. So, and herpes, gingival stomatitis, is also an important differential diagnosis. Self-healing, self-resolving disease, not much complications. But what is, before we finish, two important diseases of enteroviruses. Enterovirus D68. This virus caused a huge outbreak of respiratory disease in children. Enterovirus D68 was first observed in Canada, in the US and Canada, and spread throughout the globe, Asia, Europe, and South America. The disease was observed in children mainly, but adults with immunocompromised adults, adults with lung disease also had manifestations. The manifestations were fever, cough, wheezing. Some patients had severe respiratory disease, and they required to be on ventilator in the ICU for some days. Some patients reported neurological complications like acute flaccid myelitis, cranial nerve dysfunction. It's important to note that in enterovirus D68 disease, shedding of the virus in CSF, in CNS disease, or in stool, because it's ultimately a picoRNA virus, was not good. The best sample is a respiratory sample, a throat swab, or a nasopharyngeal throat swab, or a LRTI, a lower sample like BAL, mini BAL in severe cases. A representative respiratory sample is the better sample than stool or CSF for this picoRNA virus. Okay. Also, rarely, before we finish, is the neonatal disease caused by enteroviruses. Now, these enteroviruses are shed precorally, right? So, when they are shed in the precorally, from the mother, if the mother may have asymptomatic infection, she may be shedding the virus in the feces. Contamination of the birth canal by fecal contamination during delivery, that is natally. See, when we classify mother to fetal vertical transmission, it's prenatal, that is transplacental, natal, during labor, and postnatal, after delivery. Okay, so these infections, neonatal infections caused by enteroviruses, are usually natal. Fecal contamination of birth canal from the mother's feces, or postnatal from the and secretion of the mother, or nosocomially from the healthcare workers in the nurseries. It's very rarely congenital or prenatal or transplacental. It's natal or postnatal. Coxsackie B virus and ecoviruses are the ones which are fulminantly which cause disease. This disease could be fulminant or fatal in some babies, in neonates. Two forms are there. Either the babies have encephalomyocarditis syndrome, in the as the name suggests, encephalo, CNS, and myocarditis. Suddenly a healthy baby, on getting the virus from the natal or postnatally from these sources, becomes apneic, has respiratory difficulty, and has cyanosis. On examination, the child is tachycardic, shows ECG changes of myocarditis and some amount of meningoencephalitis. The course could be fulminant or fatal in some of these babies. The other manifestation of neonatal enterovirus disease is hemorrhagic hepatitis syndrome, where ecoviruses, especially ecovirus 11, is the main cause here. Here is Coxsackie and eco or both. In encephalomyocarditis. Here, it's mainly eco, of the eco, eco 11. The baby is lethargic, poorly feeding, and goes on to develop jaundice, profuse hemorrhage, and renal failure. The mortality is higher in this situation. So these are the two neonatal syndromes caused by natal or postnatal acquisition of the neonate by Coxsackie B or eco viruses, leading to a possible fulminant fatal course of encephalomyocarditis syndrome or the hemorrhagic hepatitis syndrome. We finished the lecture with a memory of this person. You know who this person is? He is Franklin Roosevelt, the 32nd president of the US. He was the president from 1933 to 1945. But around 12 years before he had become the president, he had a neurological disease which was at that time, with those years, diagnosed which was clinically thought to be paralytic polio, and later it was confirmed to be most possibly polio. He then made the foundation for the infantile paralysis, the March of Dimes, in 1938, because he himself had polio. And he, throughout his tenure as the US president, he was in crutches and wheelchair, and he did his the optimum duty despite having polio, despite having this disability. So this lecture ends with the message that no disability takes us back, and we can do well and we can do good in life with any form of disability if we have the courage and the positivity to do so. Thank you so much. Was I audible throughout? Is anybody there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yes, sir.